a beautiful and powerful God who came to earth. He took on the form of man and he came to earth that we might be saved and live with him in eternity. What a beautiful, powerful, mighty name of Jesus Christ. And that is why we come together to worship him. That is why we just celebrated Christmas.
Yes.
Because he came.
Yes.
He came that we might live. So we had this celebration of Christmas. Some will say, well, I don't celebrate Christmas then because that's not really when he came. I don't care when you celebrate Christ coming.
Amen.
The fact is he came.
Amen.
And he's coming again.
Yes.
I think the kids might have something going on. So you can take them anytime. They can be released anytime. We just say, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for your power and your presence and your beauty and your might and your salvation. And your presence. We just thank you, Lord. We just thank you. And in this season of celebration, you know, some of us have celebrated the same way we've always done, but some of us have celebrated a little differently. And that's okay. We've all celebrated this living Lord Jesus. And now we find ourselves in this week between Christmas and New Year's. You see, we've had kind of a rough year. Most of the time at New Year's, we look back and we say, well, you know, maybe I did this okay, maybe I did that okay, maybe this was tough, maybe that was tough. Well, I don't see a person in this room that this year has not impacted in one way or another.
Amen.
Or you online. We say thank you for joining in and welcome, and we know that you are impacted also, and that's why you're watching online. So we've all been impacted with challenges, with hurts and distresses, financial struggles, some broken relationships, sicknesses and death. We're all impacted. Shutdowns in our state. You know, I just listened on the news to this a chef in Minneapolis who, when they announced that the shutdowns were going to continue for the restaurants, just outdoor dining, he's dressed in his chef garb, and the tears are just pouring down his face. And he says, you know, this is my lifelong dream, to be a chef. And I've put everything I have into this business, all of my finances, all of my resources, my heart, everything into this. And I just can't do it. I have nothing left. And so this, with this announcement, is my last day of business in my restaurant. See, it impacts us all. I think it's safe to say that most people would say, I don't ever want to do 2020 again.
Amen.
Never again. You know, my daughter in the background here, she was with some of the first shutdowns being in the restaurant business. It's been a tough year. Yeah, so, you know, it's been a tough year for all of us. Well, you know, God still works in the midst of a tough year.
Amen.
Amen.
And a few weeks ago, I was praying before church on a Sunday. And I sit in my chair every morning. I've got this big bank of windows. And this particular Sunday, the wind was whipping up so fiercely. Some of you might remember that day that the wind was so fierce. It's like, I don't remember having something that fierce like that in the same way. But the pine tree that I'm looking at is bending almost in half. Almost in half. That oak tree just stood there. Not even the branches bristled in the wind. It just stood there, strong and tall. And I felt like the Lord was speaking. I shared this with the intercessors that morning. Tell you what, if you're not coming to Sunday morning intercessory prayer, you're really missing out because the Lord confirms so much during that prayer time. But I felt like the Lord was speaking to me. I sensed in my spirit that he was saying, when the winds of discord and change blow against you, remember that you are an oak of righteousness, planted by streams of living water, a planting of the Lord. Nothing can sway or break you because you are a planting of the Lord. Nothing, absolutely nothing. And it just takes me back to Isaiah 61, when Isaiah says, the Spirit of the Lord was upon me to bring good news. Then you skip down a couple of verses and he says, to grant those who mourn a spirit of praise. To grant those who are weary the oil of gladness. To grant those who are just trodden down hope. It's my paraphrase. And those people he will call oaks of righteousness, the planting of the Lord, that he may be glorified. You see, we stand strong that he might be glorified. The good news of Jesus Christ coming in the flesh is what we just celebrated. The children just shared the story of his birth. It's so fun watching the kids. I love watching the children. But so much truth. And you know, it's so easy for us to receive it from a child, isn't it? So much truth. He came to redeem the world from sin and death. That is why he came. That is why he clothed himself with humanity. He came to change all of the mourning into praise and gladness. The resulting righteousness is his doing. That's his plan, that he may be glorified. You know, it's too easy in a year like we've had to fall into survival mode. We've all been tempted. I'm just going to assume that we've all been tempted to just do what I need to do to get to the next thing. Just continue on. And sometimes even people's thoughts become futile or they try to escape, like into the year 2021, as if 2021 is going to be a magic pill and solve all of our issues. But this survival mode we see with people who've experienced multiple traumas in their life, they knew just what they need to survive. It's as if their spirits have gone asleep or they've become lukewarm. And lukewarm is a sign of hope deferred. Lukewarm, asleep in our spirit. That's like that pine tree being bent by the buffeting wind. Proverbs 13:12 says it this way. Hope deferred makes the heart sick, but desire fulfilled is a tree of life. You see, this word for fulfilled also means coming. We could say it this way. If the hope that I have tarries too long, I can become sick or fall asleep. But when the desire I have or the hope I have, I know it's coming, then, whoa, all bets are off. I can do anything. I have that tree of life, Jesus Christ, living in me. So desire coming is a tree of life. You know, Jesus said in the midst of John's alienation on the island of Patmos, after he was beaten, persecuted, he says to him, behold, I am coming. In fact, three times in the chapter Revelation 22, Jesus says, behold, I am coming quickly. So let's go to Revelation 22. Very last writing in the Bible, Revelation 22. I'm going to start with verse 10. And he said to me, do not seal up the words of the prophecy of this book, for the time is near. Let the one who does wrong still do wrong. Let the one who is filthy still be filthy. And let the one who is righteous still practice righteousness. And the one who is holy still keep himself holy. Behold, I am coming quickly, says Jesus. And my reward is with me to render to every man according to what he has done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end. Blessed are those who wash their robes so that they may have the right to the tree of life and may enter by the gates into the city. Outside are the dogs and the sorcerers and the immoral persons and the murderers and the idolaters and everyone who loves and practices lying. I, Jesus, have sent my angel to testify to you these things for the churches. I am the root and the descendant of David, the bright morning star. The Spirit and the bride say, come. And let the one who hears say, come. And let the one who is thirsty come. Let the one who wishes take the water of life without cost. You see, the winds of discord and change cannot bend and break those who are planted in the Lord Jesus Christ. For he, our hope, is coming quickly. So what is righteousness? Why is it important? And what does it mean that Jesus is coming quickly? Those are the three questions I want to answer this morning. The book of Revelation was given to John in order to reveal the Christ and what the future held for Christ followers. It's a book of pictorial languages. You know, there's been a lot of discourse on what's happening when and how and what it's going to look like. I'm not going to talk about that today. So sorry, all of you who love the book of Revelations, we're not going to that. What I want to focus on is Christ's return and who he's coming for. Because I need a message of hope, and I think you do too. So what is righteousness? Verse 11 of Revelation 22 says, let the one who does wrong still do wrong, and the one who is filthy still be filthy. And let the one who is righteous still practice righteousness, and the one who is holy still keep himself holy. You see, the one who does wrong is the one who is caught up in continual or repeated offenses, sin against God, a holy, pure, and blameless God. We're born that way, an offense to God. And only Jesus Christ can help us not be an offense to God. But the one who does wrong is an offense to God. They're what the psalmist refers to as those who dwell in parched places, away from the source of water. And because they have a bent towards evil, they will continually do evil. So we all know people. We maybe were one of those people at one time. We probably were. Who just, no matter how hard you tried, you just did bad things. Because you have this bent towards evil. It's called the sin nature. Romans 3:23 tells us that none is righteous, not one is righteous. So some of you might say, aren't these two scriptures in contradiction of one another? There's no one righteous, not even one, and yet we're still to practice righteousness. How does that happen? Well, you know, we're to practice righteousness and keep holy, but that's a contradiction we have to wrestle with. Paul says, all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, and the wages of that sin is death. Here's the thing. Jesus imparts his righteousness to those who believe in him.
Amen.
Those verses are not in contradiction at all. We aren't righteous on our own, but Jesus Christ imparts the very righteousness of himself into us the day we believe. To be righteous is to be innocent. Cleared from all charges. Can you imagine standing before a judge? He's got this whole list of charges. You know you're guilty. And he says, pardoned. Moves on to the next case. That's Jesus. Cleared from all charges. For anyone who has submitted themselves to Christ Jesus as Lord, you are made morally pure without offense to God because of Jesus Christ in you. The Christ follower, the true believer, has been made a fitting sanctuary for Christ to dwell. This is righteousness, the very dwelling place for a holy God because of Jesus Christ in you. Amazing, beautiful, holy, and powerful Jesus Christ. And we must employ every gift he gives us, starting with salvation and then walking through life by the power of the Holy Spirit. This class we're going to give, it's going to be amazing. Even if you think you know everything about the Holy Spirit or you've taken a class before, we can always learn new things, right, Pastor?
Amen.
We can always learn new things about who God is. The oak of righteousness simply means a strong or mighty tree. To be strong, a tree must tap into the source of water and then reach up into the light. You see, the light is where their food comes from. So we need the water of Holy Spirit. We need the food of Jesus Christ. And the righteousness of God dwells within. Nothing will bend or break us. Can you tell me what might cause a tree to fall prematurely? Anybody? I'm sorry?
I think he said chainsaw.
A chainsaw. Well, that's true. That is absolutely true, a chainsaw. That's not my notes, but that is true. A chainsaw would cause it to fall early.
Wind.
Although we talked about the wind might not, if it's planted firmly and reaching up.
Disease. Sin.
Insects. Who said rot?
I did.
Rot from within.
Woodpecker.
A woodpecker will go after the bugs that are feeding on that rot within. Mm-hmm. Rot from within. A hardness of heart towards God, towards what he's trying to do. A futility of thought. Because, you know, if we start thinking down the wrong way, these negative thoughts, pretty soon we get calloused towards God. Mm-hmm. Giving over of yourself to sensuality. Mm-hmm. Being greedy, being impure. But, you know, we didn't learn Christ this way, did we? No. Christ is all powerful over every single thing we go through.
Amen.
Righteousness is a state of being. The doing of right things flows out of that state of being. You see, too often we think we have to get right before we come to God. And he says, you come to me, I'll make you righteous, and then you will do right things. You don't have to get yourself right. You don't have to get rid of all of your bad habits. You don't have to do this or that to come to Christ. You come to Christ, and he's going to cause you to not want to do those things.
Amen.
And his righteousness that's been imparted in you will flow out of you so that you do right things. Righteousness is important. And the reason it's important is because we tell others who Christ is by the way we live. Righteousness is important. Do you find yourself striving to be holy only to fall flat on your face? Because we're not relying in God's righteousness. Now, I'll admit, I've wrestled a little this year. I've been disappointed. Even confessing to pastor, you know, I've been a little angry. Things haven't turned out the way they should turn out. You know, we all have this idea of how things should turn out. But you know, why do you suppose an oak tree can just stand there when everything comes against it? It's because it's anchored. It's anchored deep, and it's growing near abundant water. And so if we find ourselves struggling, we need to get back to Christ.
Amen.
If he's in us, get back to Christ. Know who he is. Know his character. Know what he's saying about a certain situation. And allow Holy Spirit to teach you and lead you. Because here's the deal. Do you know the righteous will never be moved? The righteous will be remembered forever. The righteous is not afraid of bad news. I remember getting the news of cancer. And Rick and I just were not afraid. And the reason we weren't afraid is because we were rooted and anchored in Jesus Christ. And of course, he healed and delivered. But even if he hadn't, we were rooted in Christ Jesus. So bad news cannot make the righteous man fear. The righteous man's heart is firm, and he trusts in the Lord. These are all found in Psalm 112. You see, if you're a believer in Jesus Christ, you are the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. The winds of discord and change cannot bend and break those who are firmly planted in the Lord Jesus Christ, for he, our hope, is coming quickly. Verse 17 of 22 says, and the Spirit and the bride say, come. And let the one who hears say, come. And let the one who is thirsty come. Let the one who wishes take the water of life without cost. The Spirit and the bride welcome Jesus. They beckon his coming. His Spirit within us beckons or calls to him and says, come, Lord Jesus. At the marriage supper of the Lamb, the bride is adorned in clean, fine linen, the righteous acts of the saints. She's adorned with character, righteousness, and piety toward God. Perfection in Christ and calling for his imminent return. Christ will return.
Amen.
He came as a baby at Christmas. He offered his life that we might have eternal life with him, and he's coming again.
Yeah.
He's coming quickly. Jesus says, I am coming. This is the same word that John used when he was in prison, John the Baptist, and he was awaiting execution, and he sent his disciples to Jesus and said, are you the expected one? Or should we look for someone else? Are you the expected one? That word coming is expected or expectation. There was an expectation of Messiah then, which was fulfilled with his coming, and we have an expectation of his future coming again. Jesus, who was and is to come. You know, we probably need to pay less attention to the calendar and thinking that just because we flip the day in a calendar, everything's going to get all better. And we should pay closer attention to what God is doing. What season are we in? What's he doing around us? What's happening in the times? You see, if we pay closer attention to what God is doing, we probably won't get so buffeted by the wind, and we can stand through it all. So pay less attention to the calendar of man. Revelation 22:7 says, and behold, I am coming quickly. Blessed is the one who heeds the words of the prophecy of this book. And 12 says, behold, I am coming. My reward is with me to render to every man according to what he has done. And verse 20, he who testifies to these things says, yes, I am coming quickly. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. He is coming. John is told in verse 10, do not seal up the words of the prophecy of this book, for the time is near. Why do you suppose he was told not to seal up the words of the book? You see, there's a set time for Messiah to come again. There was a set time for Messiah to come as a baby, and there is a set time for him to come again as a conquering king.
Yeah.
The set time is fixed, and it cannot be changed. God alone knows the time of Christ's return. You know, when Daniel was given an interpretation of a dream or a vision, he was told to seal it up. But John is told, don't seal it up. He's told to reveal God's plan. Do you ever wonder why? I think we need to wake up.
Yes.
We need to wake up, and we need to know what's coming, and we need to pay attention, and we need to get our household in order.
Right.
Amen.
Because he is coming, and he's coming quickly.
Yeah.
The word quickly doesn't necessarily mean within a certain time frame. You know, I've read this for years. He's coming quickly. This is how I've read it. He's coming soon. But you know, we're 2,000 years beyond when he came in the first bodily form. So, yes, it is sooner than it was, but quickly doesn't mean soon. Doesn't necessarily mean soon. It means suddenly. Suddenly he is coming again. Luke 2:13 and 14 says, the kids alluded to this, the shepherds were in the field, the angel came to announce the birth of Messiah. And 13 and 14 says, and suddenly there appeared a host, a heavenly host, a multitude with the angel, praising and singing God, saying, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among men who is pleased. Suddenly is like when the Holy Spirit fell in the upper room. 120 were praying, and they were praying, and they were praying, and they were praying, and it didn't seem like anything was necessarily happening, and suddenly, Holy Spirit fell, and every single person in that room was empowered. Suddenly is when Paul and Silas were arrested and beaten for preaching the gospel, and they were thrown into the inner prison, and they were praising, and they were worshiping, and suddenly, the prison doors flew open. Quickly in this passage means without delay. At the set time, at the proper time, when the time is just right, Jesus is coming again.
Amen.
Now, not one of us know that time. But we can watch what God is doing. We can watch what's happening in our world. Mm-hmm. And we can be ready. We can wake up and we can be ready.
Yes.
We must be ready. We must be. In conclusion, this Jesus, the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, he is the root of the offspring of David, the bright morning star. The angels heralded his song, his coming as a baby. We sing it. Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn king. But today, I believe we also need to sing, hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the coming King, because he is coming. He doesn't want us to be caught unaware. This pandemic caught us unaware, but not him. He's always aware. He always knows what's going on, and he will use everything to bring glory to his name in your life and in mine. He doesn't want us to despair. Sometimes circumstances can cause us to despair. We have a lot of despair going on right now, especially around Christmas time. You know, people have problems in their families and things just aren't quite right and their expectations aren't met or they're away from their family or isolated. You know, a lot of circumstances can bring a lot of despair. He doesn't want us to despair. You know, the chef story that I told you about, that man was despairing. He was a broken man. And we have a lot of broken people in this world, and they're despairing. But God is so much bigger and higher and greater than any despair you and I might face. He is more powerful than any despair that our neighbors may face. He is over and above any circumstance or any trial that we might have gone through or are going through now. He wants us to know him and the power of his resurrection. That's why I told John, don't seal up the books. I want the people to know me. I want them to know me as their Savior, and I want them to know me as my coming King. Because I don't want them to be hopeless. I don't want them to be futile. So if you find yourself overwhelmed and despairing and uncertain in times like this, talk to God. Confess any doubts you might have. Confess any actions or attitudes that might not be in accordance with his will or his ways. And receive a fresh breath of Holy Spirit. God always wants to give us a fresh breath of his Spirit. He doesn't want us stuck in these things. See, there's no power on earth. There's no stress we endure. There's no hardship which befalls us that can fell an oak of righteousness. Nothing. We can stand upright and strong no matter the situations. I just want to share a story as Ruby and Craig are coming forward. What if you're listening either here in the church this morning or online, you say, I'm not sure if I'm a mighty tree of God. That's okay if you're unsure. Because, you know, we have the answer. We have Jesus Christ.
Amen.
So it doesn't matter if you're unsure. I was reading in the financial section just this week about Ramsey Solutions. You know, Dave Ramsey does a lot with financial peace, helping people get on their feet and not be in debt. Ramsey Solutions bought two debt collection companies, acquiring in his own company $10 million worth of debt. And then he and his employees called 8,000 people to tell them their debt had been paid. Mm-hmm. They didn't have to enter a contest. They didn't have to jump through any hoops. They didn't have to make a payment plan. Their debt was just free and clear. One woman said, I had been carrying that ball and chain of debt around for years, and I didn't see a way out. And I've been given a way out. Dave was asked, why the heck would anyone scoop up $10 million worth of debt and pay it off just like that? Well, the answer is simple: to show the love of Jesus Christ. You see, this whole completely forgiving a debt has been done before by him. And no other gift could compare to that one. But we felt this was one small way we could continue to pass on that love. Jesus Christ has paid your debt and mine. The day he shed his blood on that cross, just like the people who relieved of the debt, you and I can be too. We just open the gift and he imparts his righteousness. We believe, we receive, and we walk in a new life. Jesus Christ, God in human form, came to earth. The reason we celebrate Christmas, he lived, he died, he was buried, and he rose again.
Amen.
And he's coming again.
Amen.
And he will impart righteousness to those who ask. So you just need to ask. We're here to pray with you, whether you've been a believer just a short time, even today, or whether you've been a believer a long time and have just been discouraged. We're here to pray with you. Pull one of us aside and say, hey, I just need some prayer. Let's not go into 2021 with a false hope.
Yeah.
2021 is not going to save us. It's not going to deliver us. Things might not change. But the one who doesn't change eternally is the one we will put our hope in. For he is coming, and he's coming again. Amen. Let's just pray. Lord, we just thank you. We thank you for your word. We thank you that you are a mighty God who loves us and reaches down to us and continues to reach down to us and speaks to us, Lord. Thank you that you impart your righteousness into those who believe, and nothing, nothing, nothing can bend or break or separate them from you. And so we look forward expectantly to you, expectantly to your second coming. Thank you, Lord Jesus. May our lives